Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Meeta Chauhan. I'm a consultant in OBGYN working with Cloudnine Hospital, the Whitefield branch. Today, I'm here to discuss about the different modes of delivery and basically answer your questions regarding vaginal delivery and a cesarean section. So I'll just give you a brief outline about the two and then we can continue with the session. So basically, you've been trying and doing your best to have a healthy baby. This is your 9 month of pregnancy. And finally, you get to take a healthy baby home. And that happens, the last course, that happens through the childbirth. Now we have two modes of delivery. One is a vaginal delivery, which is often called as normal delivery. And second is an abdominal delivery, which is basically means a cesarean section. Now what is the basic difference between the two modes of delivery? Now in terms of vaginal delivery, it's a lengthy procedure, which usually takes around 18 to 20 hours. It is divided into three stages basically. The first stage is from the beginning of pain till you start pushing. Second stage is from the pushing effort to a delivery of baby. And third stage is basically the afterbirth, the coming out of placenta. Now, which is most of the times aided by giving a short cut in your perineum, which is called an episiotomy, which aids in the delivery. When it comes to cesarean section, it's under anesthesia and we give you a cut over your abdomen, go through different layers of your body and then reach the uterus and deliver a baby. Apart from this, nothing much is very different. You still have bleeding, you still have pain. Now the reasons why somebody would undergo a normal or somebody could undergo a cesarean section, that is something that we can discuss in details. The outcomes of a normal or outcomes of cesarean section, or the difficulties that you face during normal or after normal, same with difficulties with cesarean and post cesarean section, I'm here to answer all your queries. So now we start about the questions thing. So now Mrs. Shivangi, she asks, if she wants to have a second child, what would I prefer, normal or cesarean section? So Shivangi, I'm assuming that you had a cesarean section the first time and this is your query whether you can try for a normal delivery second time. Yes, it's definitely possible. Now there are certain criteria that we need to fulfill to try for a second normal after the first cesarean section. First thing first is the difference between the two deliveries, as in the difference of years between the two deliveries. Normally we would prefer 3 to 4 years of gap between the first and the second. Second is, you should not have a recurring reason for a cesarean section. Reasons being, let's say you had placenta previa or you had a surgery over the uterus. These things say that you should be trying for a cesarean section rather than going for a normal delivery. And third, if you had complications with your first normal delivery, then I would definitely opt for a cesarean section. Like if you had a third degree perineal tear or a fourth degree perineal tear, wherein it could happen again in your second delivery, then we would recommend go for a cesarean section. Now Sneha, she asks, how does cesarean section delivery affect my tummy overall? Sneha, it doesn't affect much. The thing is that the pregnancy changes happens the same way whether you try for a normal cesarean section. And it depends on how early and how soon you go back to your routine. Now what I usually recommend is, first week post delivery, start with your basic walk. After 4 to 6 weeks of delivery, you can do whatever you want. As in, you can start with any exercise that you want. Of course, start small, start with 10 minutes a day, and then you can jump up to 30 to 45 minutes as well. So it doesn't change, your cesarean section doesn't change the outcome of how your tummy looks or feels post delivery. It's going to be the same as normal delivery. Now Harpreet asks is, if fetus is in breech presentation at 8th month, does it remain the same or can we change his or her position? Is there any way to make his position right? Secondly, if there is no chance in breech presentation to have to go through cesarean section, then mother will feel the labor pains the full time or not? Or does she have to go on to her due date, normally get an operated? Okay, so basically what she's trying to ask is, if it's a breech presentation at 8 months of pregnancy, that is roughly around 34 to 36 weeks of pregnancy, is there a possibility that the baby can turn by itself? Yes, there is a chance. 97% times they turn by 37, 38 weeks of pregnancy. Second is there anything that we can do to turn the baby? Yes, there is something called external cephalic version, in which we try to, under supervision and guidance, we try to rotate the baby and try to bring the head down. But most often it doesn't work very well. Most likely it ends up in early labor, or you could end up with, fetal distress and we end up with cesarean section anyways. And the third she's asking, is it any different undergoing a delivery with a breech presentation than a cephalic presentation? Now, the complications of having a breech delivery, yes, they're different than somebody who has a cephalic delivery. Cephalic is a head-down delivery, basically. At times, the cord prolapse can happen. That is the cord coming out before the actual, you know, baby delivers. Or at times, after coming head, the head which is going to come out later gets stuck and you're not able to have a easy or a smooth or uncomplicated delivery. So this is some of the reasons why we recommend, if it's a first pregnancy and with a breech delivery, which presentation, we would recommend go for a cesarean section. Now the last segment of a question was just that she should have to go on her due date normally and get upgraded. So the current thing is that here we, in the current age, we just have one or two babies. And we would not want to take any unnecessary risk when we've actually, you know, done the best through the 9 months of pregnancy. Unnecessary risk to try a normal for a breech delivery. So my recommendation is, if the baby is 2.83 kgs up, I would recommend for a breech delivery to go for a planned cesarean section rather than going for a normal delivery. But then again, we put forth the consequences of both. And if you decide that you want to give it a try for a normal, we do our best to train you throughout the pregnancy and to help you through the delivery process as well. Okay, now Sonali. Sonali asks, what precautions should, if going for second cesarean section before second year, and where will be the stitches, at the same place or at another place? Now Sonali, of course we'd prefer that there should be a gap of minimum 3 years between the first and second pregnancy in terms of a normal, previous normal. And we recommend, if possible, 4 to 5 years of gap between the first normal or first cesarean and the second cesarean section. Now, having said that, if somebody gets pregnant within 2 years of pregnancy, all we can do is to keep your body and mind healthy throughout the pregnancy. Try to do our best to, you know, pick up problems or complications that could arise in pregnancy and during the delivery process as well. And guide you accordingly during your labor process as well. Whatever you decide, whether you want to try for a VBAC, that is a normal delivery after cesarean section, or whether we will go for a planned cesarean section. Now stitches, we usually give it on the same site, unless and until you had a previous vertical cut. We give you a horizontal cut. So unless and until you had a previous vertical cut, if you had a horizontal cut, we go through the same stitches and we deliver the baby. Now Himanshi, she asks, okay, it's in Hindi. So meri normal delivery mein delivery ko 2.5 years ho gaye hain and she's still feeding the baby. Phir bhi mera tummy bahar hai, andar nahi ho raha hai and mujhe periods ki bhi problem rehti hai. Exercise karo to periods aate hain, sare test bhi kar liye hain, normal hain and she's around 24 years of age. My weight is 70 kgs. Okay, so I'm assuming she's asking why her belly has not gone inside after a delivery, right? Whether it's a normal or cesarean section. So, Himanshi, the reason is just lack of exercise. See, the tummy, it stretches a lot during your 9 months of pregnancy. The muscle breaks down, the protein breaks down. It is not going to come back to its pre-pregnancy state without effort. So, if you start doing exercise, toning your muscle, the belly muscle, it is definitely going to go in. The longer you wait after delivery, the harder it gets. So that's my recommendation, if possible, within 3 to 6 months of your delivery, start doing some form of exercise so that you can attain your pre-pregnancy status a little early. Now Sharda. Now Sharda asks, after cesarean section, when to plan for second baby? Like I answered before, if possible, 4 to 5 years of gap, otherwise minimum 3 years of gap between the two babies. Now Priyanka, she asks me, how do I know that the labor pain has started and during pain or delivery when I have to push? Yeah, Priyanka. So basically the pre-labor thing starts somewhere around 37, 38 weeks of pregnancy. That means your body is going to start changing. You would have severe backache and the tummy will start contracting and you will experience pain. Then again, it takes almost like 1 to 2 weeks to get into a proper labor thing. Now, actual labor pain means you get a contraction every 2 minutes and it should last practically 45 to 55 seconds. This is almost like a minute's time. Most of us, we are able to tolerate the pain when it's happening probably an hour. But by the time it starts happening every 15, 20 minutes, I would recommend you to come to the hospital and we do the monitoring for you. Now, labor, like I told you, a first timer usually lasts almost 15 to 18 hours and second timer is somewhere around 8 to 10 hours. So here, when we monitor you and we see the progress of the progress of the baby happening, dilatation happening, we need to reach a certain stage, which is almost like 10 centimeters, and the baby's head at the perineum, then is when we ask you to start pushing. So you push when you get the urge to push, and with your pushing, the head descends even more, and finally we have a delivery. Now, Mithali asks me, how to have a normal delivery with less stitches? Is it possible? Okay, so Mithali, how it goes is, usually first timers, we end up giving you a episiotomy, that is a cut in private areas, to facilitate a smooth and uncomplicated delivery. Now let's say Mithali, if you've been physically very fit and very active during your pregnancy, and if you do your best to push out the baby, and when the baby's head stretches the perineum real well, then we have to give you a very small cut, which is probably a 2 centimeter cut. But let's say if the pushing effort is not very great, or if let's say the baby is too big for your body, and we somehow have to help you pulling the baby out, then of course the cut becomes bigger because we have to accommodate instruments to pull out the baby as well. So usually the cut is given the first time, but let's say if you have a second or third baby, a normal delivery, you wouldn't need a stitch at all. Now Shilpa asks me, my first delivery was through cesarean section, so what are the chances of repeat cesarean section when I plan my second child? So I think I covered this answer a few while back. There are certain set of criteria which, if fulfilled, improves the chances of trying for a second vaginal delivery. One, of course, is the time frame between the two, if possible 4 to 5 years of gap. Second is recurring reasons for cesarean section shouldn't be there. And of course, your fitness and your stamina to undergo a normal delivery. Barring that, of course, the baby also does the same. Now Deepa asks me, what are the side effects of cesarean section? So frankly speaking, Deepa, not much. Only thing is that cesarean section means a bigger cut, means a little extra blood loss, and slightly increased possibility of having infections post-delivery. But having said that, most of the patients do not need much more than a 24 hours of rest. Within 24 hours, we get them up and about. 2.5 days, you walk and go home. And the moment you reach home, you do everything for you and your baby. So by 1 week of time, you're back as good as new, doing everything that you want. So not much of a difference between a cesarean section and normal delivery. Having said that, of course, you would have to have prepared in pregnancy with your physical fitness and physical stamina, which is these days, this is the core thing that we make you physically and mentally fit throughout the pregnancy so that you have an easier delivery and an easier post-delivery outcome. Okay, so Neha asks me, can I eat before surgery? Neha, the basic requirement for food or water, the cutoff is rather 6 to 8 hours prior to surgery, you have to stop eating. Now, if it's an emergency, then of course, we accommodate. We give you the information and we do take high risk consent and we do the surgery in case of emergencies. But if it's a planned routine surgery, we would prefer at least 6 to 8 hours of no food and no water. Now, Radhika asks me, what is the normal delivery process? Now, Radhika, normal delivery is a very lengthy thing. So what does it actually mean? Normal delivery means having a delivery through a woman's birthing passage. It takes almost like 15 to 18 hours and we have different stages to it. So basically from the onset of pain to the descent of the baby, keeping in mind that everything is going, the monitoring is all perfect, the baby's heartbeat is all perfect, and then coming out through the birthing canal, that is actually a normal delivery process. And like I mentioned before, we usually aid you by giving you a small cut so that it becomes easy for the baby to come out, followed by the afterbirth, and then we stitch up the cut. Now, Ruhani asks me, what are the symptoms of normal delivery? So, like I explained earlier, mostly it starts with your backache and the stomach becoming hard and painful, and then you feel a tug in your vagina, and then you can feel some amount of bleed coming out. That's actually called show. This is something which starts a labor, keeps on increasing though over time, and then ultimately at the end of 15 to 18 hours, you have a delivery thing. Now, for some, you could actually break waters as well, but that is not a sign of a labor. We usually, in labor, we break your waters to facilitate the labor thing. Sonali, is normal delivery more painful? Yes, Sonali. Normal delivery is extremely painful, but that is what we do. We try to prepare you in pregnancy so that you are physically and mentally prepared to undergo that pain. Now, we have different kinds of analgesia which we can give you in labor. We have injections and we have gas and we have something called epidural. But the thing is that if we give it to you from the beginning of your labor, the labor is going to halt. And if you give it to you at the end, when you're about to push, you would realize the importance of pushing. So yes, it is painful, but we still can give you painkillers. Pain management can be done in the mid, you know, half of your labor thing. Now, Shilpa asks me, how does a cesarean affect the baby in terms of causing him health complication? Okay, so Shilpa, the long-term complications, none. But the, you know, the immediate complications, I wouldn't call it complications. Now, when the baby is pushed out of vagina, the baby is compressed. The baby's lungs are compressed and that pushes out the water from the lungs and it becomes quite easy for the baby to breathe. In terms of cesarean section, this process, this pushing out, this compression doesn't happen. So at times, the babies could take a little extra time to just push out that extra water, which is practically very normal. And most babies, they of course would need, you know, just observation. They would not need anything else. But apart from this, no long-term complications in future just because you had a cesarean section. Okay. Now, Tina. Tina asks me, what is the recovery period after cesarean section? As fast as you want, Tina. So we get you out of bed within 12 to 18 hours. You have to, you know, get up and use the restroom. 24 hours, you have to walk around in the corridor. 2.5 days, you walk and go home. And then 1 week of time, you have to do some form of exercise, 10 to 15 minutes of walk. So if you start, if you get back to your routine, the faster you get back to the routine, the faster is your recovery. So in olden days, of course, 1 month of hospital stay or 1 month of, you know, bed rest, all this is not done. The faster you get back to the routine, the faster your body is going to heal. Now, Meeta asks me, I have back pain after cesarean section. How can it be recovered? Now, I'm assuming, Meeta, you are attributing the back pain to probably the spinal anesthesia. So that's actually not correct. Spinal anesthesia, we will use a very thin needle, which doesn't give you backache. You know, probably can give you for a couple of days, but doesn't give you backache long term at all. What happens is during your breastfeeding phase and in your pregnancy phase also, there's a lot of calcium depletion happening because everything goes to the baby. And then the posture thing, because you have to bend over the baby every couple of hours to feed the baby. And most often, females, they ignore their own health. They do not take proper calcium supplements and do not exercise and tone the back. So this is the common reasons to have backache is deficiency of calcium, deficiency of vitamin D3, and lack of exercise. So if you have done all of it and you're still suffering from backache, I would recommend to meet up with an orthopedician. You could have, you know, something else, maybe a spine problem or maybe some muscle spasm, which could be there, and they could help you out with that. Okay, so Mrs. Har, she's asking me, if baby is in breech position and then there is also a cord around the neck, then there will be labor pain going to be there or not, because from today my 9th month has started. Okay, so Har, if the baby is in breech position, you can still get labor pains. If there is a cord around the neck, you can still have labor pains. So this doesn't preclude the labor thing at all. The question here is, with the cord around the neck, we need to see if the baby's heartbeat is going, you know, becoming irregular or not. Like I told, breech is slightly complicated vaginal delivery, and if you've decided to give it a chance, then I would recommend as soon as the labor thing starts, you rush to the hospital and be under continuous monitoring of your doctor, who does the best for you to have a delivery. Now, Shilpa asks me, what are the factors that affect the duration of return of monthly periods after delivery? Okay, Shilpa, so this is a new question. So basically what happens is your periods are based on your levels of hormone in the body. And mostly if you exclusively breastfeed your baby, till you exclusively breastfeed your baby, most often the periods do not return. Now, the logic behind is, if the feeding releases certain hormone in your body, which acts at a particular level, will release a certain set of other hormones which regulate your cycles. Now, let's say if you introduce formula milk too early, or if you introduce food for the baby too early, of course you can get the periods a little early. Now, too much of stress, or let's say if you are unwell, or too much of medication, antibiotics, all of it can again give you an early period. But usually it is, if you feed 100% exclusive breast milk, most often than not, you would not have your periods till you are exclusively breastfeeding the baby. Now Deepa asks me, one of my friends is expecting and her in-laws are against cesarean section. Why is it considered taboo by older generation? Now Deepa, this is some, probably all parents, moms, fathers, in-laws, you know, everybody thinks like that. See, in olden days, we didn't have such safe practice for a cesarean section. We didn't have such safe, you know, places to have cesarean section. such good antibiotics to take care of infections. And it was quite a risky thing because they did not, you know, let the female eat everything after cesarean section, or, you know, get back to the routine for a month's time. So this is something which, unfortunately, yes, the older generation, you know, still follows, but there is nothing to it. It's not much of a difference between a normal and cesarean section. Having said that, of course, normal is much better, but if it is required, cesarean is not bad at all. Okay, so now Rui asks me, a friend delivered today with cesarean section. Her operation was complicated, and during some complication, her uterus is removed. What precaution she needs now? Okay, sorry, it's Ruchi. Now, Ruchi, there are very few cases in which we end up doing a hysterectomy or removing the uterus with a cesarean section or post-delivery. The commonest is, of course, PBH, postpartum hemorrhage, wherein you bleed so much and none of the things that we can do, the medical or surgical, can help us conserve or save the uterus. Now, once the uterus is out, you wouldn't have your regular cycles. You wouldn't have your periods. And most often your regular hormones, the female hormones, they also start falling down. So the must thing, of course, is having calcium, if possible, throughout for the rest of your life, because that is something which will affect your bones, your body, and your spine. And of course, depending on your hormones levels, do we need any supplements or not? But it wouldn't, there's nothing direct that you can do to change something major. Small daily, day-to-day, lifestyle modification is what you need. Okay, now, Geetika asked me, are there any specific precautions to be taken after cesarean section? Okay, so Deepika, the basic difference between a normal and cesarean section is the bigger the cut, that we have a bigger cut for a cesarean and extra amount of bleed for a cesarean, and extra possibility of having an infection. So what we do is, we do give you one shot of antibiotics during the procedure. And we keep a check on your, vitals and your hemoglobin to see if there is any need for any supplements or blood. But after that, it is as good as a normal thing. As in, you get back to the routine. There is nothing that I would say you cannot do just because you had a cesarean section. The pain is slightly more for a couple of days. But then if you get used to it, or if the painkillers are helping, you get back to the routine as good as a normal. So not much, basically. Okay, so Gitika, then she asks me, second question, how to remove the stubborn stretch marks? Now, Gitika, this is one very tricky thing. Unfortunately, nothing can prevent a stretch mark. It is the stretch of the skin, that means the break of the proteins, which gives you the stretch mark. So what you have to do is to ease the break. So if you start using coconut oil, that is the best solution to it. If you start using liberal amount of, regular use of coconut oil during pregnancy, it kind of, keeps it lighter. And at times it just prevents that as well. Post-delivery, when you can, maybe in 3 months of time or 6 months of time, when you can actually exercise and tone up your body, that is when the stretch marks actually starts fading. And over time, with again moisturizing and the coconut oil thing, it can fade away. But unfortunately, it doesn't disappear 100%. Another question she asks is, what kind of diet should be followed after cesarean section? Same as normal. There's nothing that I would say you cannot do after a cesarean section. Of course, it takes a little time. Then with normal delivery, you can start eating immediately. With the cesarean section, after 6 to 8 hours, we give you something to drink. And after 12 to 24 hours, we give you something to eat. If you are able to tolerate it, you can eat whatever you want post-cesarean as well. Now, Shilpa asks me, a lot of younger women nowadays are keen to schedule an elective cesarean section despite any complications. I want to understand what aspects of normal delivery they actually want to avoid. Shilpa, they want to avoid only two things. One, of course, they do not want to take any chance of things going wrong for the baby. Now, most people who come to me, whether they come to me from the beginning of pregnancy or end of pregnancy, everybody is concerned with one thing: the doctor, everything should be perfect for my baby. The first priority for anybody, for any mother, is to have a healthy baby. Now, they have this notion in head, which is most often, correct also, because cesarean section is a very timed, framed, everything under control thing, that if we do this, the baby is going to be 100% all okay. So most often it is that reason. And second, of course, is pain. Many of us are still scared of the labor pain because it is too much and it goes on for too long. So the common reason people opt for cesarean section these days is, one is, of course, they want this 100% surety and guarantee for the baby, and second is to avoid pain. Now Rita asked me, how soon can we start exercising after any type of delivery? Like I mentioned, Rita, earlier, depending on how much your body allows you and how much time you are able to balance between yourself and for your, you know, baby. So if possible, I recommend after a week of delivery, whether it's a normal cesarean section, I would recommend, if possible, 10 minutes of walk, especially in the sunlight, because it does make a lot of difference. And if possible, within 1 month to 6 weeks of delivery, if you want, and if possible, you can get back to your exercise. Start small and you can, of course, increase that. Now, Amrita's asked me, have heard about specific tummy bells after cesarean section. What kind of bells should be used? Is it recommended? Okay, Amrita. So the bells that we're talking about, basically, after normal delivery as well, the purpose of that belt is to support your back. It cannot push your belly inside. So you can start it immediately after normal delivery. And after the cesarean section, I would recommend wait for a week and then you can start that. But what happens is, earlier when your uterus was so big and you had the skin stretched over it, it had support. Now the baby is out, uterus is so small and it is kind of toppling here and there. So when that happens, you have extra pain with the cesarean section when it is hitting like that. So if you wear a belt, it supports the uterus for the time being. And second, it supports your back. So you would have lesser backache post-delivery if you use a belt. Or let's say in olden days, they used to use, you know, cotton sari tied around the tummy. But it doesn't push your belly inside. Now Shilpa asked me, one of my friends had a vertical cesarean to the first section and is wondering whether that incision might get ruptured during her subsequent vaginal delivery. Shilpa, so I'm assuming you're talking about, I'm not sure whether you're talking about the vertical incision on the uterus or on the skin, on the tummy, the belly outside, abdomen basically. So if it was a vertical incision over the abdomen, nothing to worry, it's not going to, you know, open up at all. But if you're talking about the vertical incision over the uterus, then of course it has a higher chance of rupture opening up as in comparison to somebody who'd had a horizontal cut. In fact, if you had a vertical incision, we recommend not to try for a normal delivery, go for a cesarean section straight away. Okay, now Pavni asks me, what supplements like calcium and iron should we continue after cesarean section and for how long? Now Pavni, even with the whatever the mode of delivery, whether you had a normal or a cesarean section, we recommend to take iron and calcium supplements for a year or as long as you feed the baby. Now, the logic is, if you have more stamina, if you have more energy levels, better energy levels rather, you'll be able to do a better job and you'll be able to feed longer. Plus, the dietary food that you take doesn't do very well in terms of iron and calcium to improve your levels of iron and calcium. So I would recommend, if possible, at least 6 months of iron post-delivery and a year of calcium. But if possible, continue the same for as long as you feed the baby. Dipali asks me, one of my friends has gestational diabetes. Does this affect the type of delivery that she might have? Okay, so Dipali, gestational diabetes, it means you develop diabetes in pregnancy, and depending on how good controlled or uncontrolled it is, it can affect the baby. Now, in general, if the sugars are very well controlled and the baby's weight is under control, then you have a very good chance at normal delivery, and I would recommend normal delivery, because gestational diabetes, it delays the healing process. But let's say the baby is too big, let's say we have something called macrosomia, a baby who is 4 kg and up, then of course the chances of normal delivery drastically comes down. Okay, Gitika asked me, my first delivery was through a vacuum, but normal delivery, and the second one a normal delivery, but both the times the doctors had given a cut, it is necessary for the second time also. Now what happens, Gitika, to give you a cut, you know, it's a decision that we need to take at the time of the actual delivery happening. Now when we give you a cut to facilitate the labor, let's say if you feel the baby, the delivery would be slightly easier if we give you a cut if the baby is too big, or let's say the baby is too small and we do not want the pressure of the perineum or a difficult labor on the baby, we give you a cut. So usually the first time do ends up with a cut. But then at the second delivery, if let's say your baby was bigger than the first time, or you were not able to push very well, or let's say the baby's heartbeat was coming down a little when you were trying to push, in those cases we give you a cut. But most often, yes, if you know things are under control, we can avoid a cut the next time. Now Bhavani, she asked me, does PCO affect the type of delivery? No Bhavani, PCO is a condition wherein you have irregular periods and, you know, times difficulty getting pregnant. But the moment you get pregnant, it doesn't do anything in the pregnancy. Of course, it increases your chances of having probably diabetes, but it doesn't affect the mode of delivery at all. Now, she asks me, thanks for previous answer. My gynecologist had told about C-sec delivery because of breech presentation and cord around the neck. Is there any possibility of changing the position? It is possible only up to 37, 38 weeks. But if there is a cord around the neck, I would not recommend that, because that means you could be pushing the baby into more danger than what it is already. So I would recommend, what your gynecologist is saying is the correct thing. Go for a planned cesarean section. Okay, Shilpa is asking me, is there any sort of vaginal injury because of tear during normal delivery? Can it cause some long-term problems to the mother? Okay, yes, Shilpa, this is not so frequent occurrence, but of course there is a possibility. See, what happens is during a normal delivery, the baby has to stretch the perineum and come out. So around that area you have the urethra, which is a urine passage, and you have the anus, which is the motion passage. Now we give you a cut so that if suppose a tear is happening, it extends only in the direction of the cut, which is away from all these important structures. But unfortunately, many times, or sometimes rather, things don't go as planned. And if you tear and involve the other areas, the motion area or the urethra, the urine area, of course complications can happen, which most often, if not taken care of immediately and sutured properly, doesn't cause long lasting effects. But unfortunately, at times, if the healing is not well, or post delivery the care is not enough, at times some passage kind of a thing can happen between the vagina and the motion area. This is something called fistula, and which is quite difficult to treat. So very unlikely, but yeah, there are certain complications of normal delivery wherein the injuries have been too extensive, and this thing has happened. Now, Anaga, she asked me, does cesarean result in back pain in later years? No, Anaga, it doesn't do that. Shilpa asks me, how can you throw some light on preterm delivery and what can be done to help prevent them? Are they be normal or cesarean section? Now, Shilpa, preterm for us is any delivery before 37 weeks of pregnancy. Unfortunately, if it's the first time you're undergoing a preterm, there is nothing that you can do in advance to prevent that, unless and until you had a short cervical length throughout the pregnancy. Now, let's say if you had a preterm delivery the first time, then there is a decent chance you could have it the second time. And then, of course, we can, do something about that. So let's say if you had short cervix, we avoid, too much of exertion for you. If we see a shortening happening, we can give you hormone supplements to improve the possibility of prolonging it. Now, the preterm delivery, the type of delivery that happens is usually depends on the baby's weight. Now, let's say if it's a 20 or 30 weaker, where it is 1.2 to 1.4 kg baby, might not be able to tolerate the stress of a normal delivery. So we would recommend a cesarean section. But let's say it's a 35, 36 weaker baby, wherein it has already reached 2.2 or 2.5 kg baby, we would let you go for a delivery. So it all depends on the day of delivery, how we decide for that. Okay, so now Gitika, she asked me, elders massage is good to keep your tummy inside after a normal delivery. How true is it? Any particular oil? So Gitika, no oil can work, and massage cannot push the belly inside. Massage is only for comfort. But when you actually start toning it, so massage wherein it can help you tone the muscle, can help you reduce your belly. But massage is basically for exercise, doesn't do much for your pushing the tummy inside. So Shalini asked me, after how many days after cesarean section can we drive two-wheeler, and how many days should we continue iron tablets? Like I mentioned earlier, Shalini, you can I would advise to continue iron tablets at least for 6 months post cesarean section, and driving a two-wheeler when your body allows it. So in fact, after 1 week of delivery, you can do whatever you want. So if you feel that you can drive, yes, you can drive after a week of delivery. Deepa, she asked me, I had a normal delivery, but I took epidural during my delivery. What are the side effects of epidural? I do get back pain sometimes. Now, Deepa, epidural is an absolutely safe form of analgesia. We use a very thin needle, which doesn't give you long-lasting effects, side effects at all. So, it is definitely not the reason for your backache. Backache most often post delivery is because you have to bend over the baby so often to feed the baby. So that is the usual cause of it. But there is nothing much that, you know, you have to take care of in terms of just because you have taken an epidural. But what I would still recommend, just have a word with your anesthetist. At times you could have something called a post-spinal, you know, post-epidural headache, which still goes off after a couple of days of delivery. So I would recommend just talk to your anesthetist for that. Now, Gitika, she asked me, any form of delivery, does anyone go through postpartum depression? Okay, Gitika, this is a very important topic that you have touched here. Yes, most young mothers, especially in the first time, they end up with some kind of depression in the couple of months post delivery. What happens is, you have been, you know, free so far, you have been alone so far, you have been doing whatever you want with your life so far, and you still do your best in this 9 months for the baby to happen. But the moment the baby comes out, your life completely changes. You have no time to eat, no time to rest for yourself, and you devote everything for your baby. So this kind of, you know, situation increases the possibility that you could end up with depression. Herein, it helps if you have been physically and mentally fit throughout the pregnancy, and if a good support system, which starts from your husband and your family and of course your doctor, we could do a lot to control that. Now, the best part, the safest thing is to prepare yourself in pregnancy to accept how much things are going to change, and then post delivery, if you face something, talk to somebody about it and we take care of it as soon as possible. Now, Sonali asks me, I'm going for my second cesarean section in March first week, and I have my first cesarean section in March 2017. What precautions should I take, and will the section stitches be at the same place or at a different place? Sonali, the section stitches would probably be at the same places. And what precautions? Just because you had a previous cesarean section, nothing much has to change here. But this time, of course, I would recommend start, get back to the routine faster, it heals your body faster. Kirti asks me, having epidural while trying for normal delivery, but later on doctor said cervix not open, then go for cesarean section. Why does this happen? Now Kirti, epidural is a labor analgesia. That means it is supposed to reduce your perception of pain. It doesn't bring down your contractions. That means contractions still keep on happening, but the amount of pain that you feel, you know, comes down. It has got nothing to do with the dilatation of the cervix to try for a normal delivery. So maybe your body didn't respond to the actual liver pains, or maybe the induced pains, there could be other reasons. The baby's head not coming down, or the baby's body being too big for your body, or there's a cord around the neck. There could be these different reasons for that. But epidural doesn't prevent the cervix from dilatation. Now Shivani asked me, can I choose between the two types? Yes, Shivani, the choice is always yours. See, what happens is, like I said earlier also, most of us, we are going to have one or two babies, and we want that extra, you know, guarantee that things are going to be okay. Now, having said that, you can still have a very healthy, safe, secure, normal delivery. So what, as a doctor, what I would do for you is give you the best of advice during the pregnancy so that you can have a healthy pregnancy, you know, fit pregnancy. And then depending on the end, the circumstances for the baby, the position of the baby, the descent of the baby, and how much can you tolerate the labor, I still give you the best of advice, and then you get to decide which one do you want. But ultimately, at the end of the day, it would be your decision to go for a normal or a cesarean section. Now Rohini, she asked me, any myths around cesarean section and vaginal delivery? The list is unending, Rohini. So the basic thing comes that cesarean is really bad and normal delivery is really good. Now, when we talk about that in terms of good or bad, this is not what we think about when we decide for that. What we decide is what is the best option at that moment for the mother and the baby. Now, the certain myths for a cesarean section is that you will have backache forever, that your body is not going to heal properly, or that you need, you know, extra 1 month or 2 months of rest to try for to get back to your routine, or that the babies are, you know, not healthy as compared to somebody who had a normal delivery. But nothing to it. It all depends on you. The faster you get back to the routine, the faster you take care of body, the better you take care of body, you're going to come back to the routine as anybody who had a normal delivery. Now, not many myths regarding vaginal delivery, but of course, some are there that babies are healthier if you had normal delivery. The immune system for the baby is much, much better if you had normal delivery. You wouldn't have backaches if you had a normal delivery. And of course, the bonding thing, that people bond much better when you had a normal delivery. But it cuts both ways. Now, I have seen mothers who had normal delivery, and just because they were in so much of pain after delivery, you know, they were not very happy after that. And I have seen patients with cesarean section who had no pain at all and still were able to bond, you know, much better. What I'm trying to say here, this last in the bonding thing, it doesn't happen. As it doesn't, you know, it doesn't get affected just because you had a normal delivery or cesarean section. So certain myths, but all myths, and most of the times inaccurate. The thing is that you prepare yourself best whichever way, you know, you decide whether it's going to be a normal or cesarean section, and the things are going to be the same. Now, Rita asked me, any risk for cesarean section delivery to the baby? Like I answered earlier, Rita, there is only one thing which directly affects the baby in cesarean section, is because it doesn't get compressed, the lungs doesn't get compressed. It could take a little time, extra time, to throw out the water from the lungs. It's like a transient thing. It just settles down after within 30 to 40 minutes most of the time. Okay, so Shilpa asks me, if a woman chooses to receive epidural for a more comfortable labor, does it cause some side effects? Now Shilpa, what epidural does is, it reduces your perception of pain. So if you do not feel the pain, you would not do your 100% to push out the baby. So what we do is, we give you epidural till at least 8 to 9 centimeters of your labor, and in the last 1 to 2 hours, we switch it off so that you feel all the pain, and then you do your best to push out the baby. Yes, when you talk about this, let's say if you do not push out the baby well, we have to use instruments to pull out the baby, because in the end, you know, you can't go for a cesarean section. So chances of instrumental deliveries can increase if we use epidural, especially if we do not cut it off, especially if we do not push. But if we cut down the epidural and if you push, do your best, it doesn't cause any side effects, or it doesn't delay the delivery thing. Now Deepa asked me, what are the common reasons for cesarean section? Now Deepa, this is very never ending long list. The commonest reason for cesarean section, if something is not being okay with the baby. Now let's say we have a very big baby, 4 kg plus, if a very small baby, less than 2 kg, or if the baby is not able to cope up with the stress of labor, that means the baby's heartbeat is going up and down, or the baby passes motion inside. Second common one are reasons where the baby is, let's say, upside down, then you would not have a normal delivery. There are maternal reasons as well. Let's say if mother has uncontrolled blood pressure, wherein she can throw a fit when she goes into labor, that is another reason. There are certain absolute reasons where you cannot try for a normal. Let's say you have a placenta previa, where the placenta is at the birth canal and the baby cannot come down. Or let's say you had a previous operation on the uterus which was not like a cesarean section. Okay. Then let's say if you have, a huge fibroid which is sitting in the way and you could not have a normal delivery. So these are the reasons why cesarean section happened, but commonest still being something not okay with the baby. And then off late, we have seen a slightly uprise in the, you know, mothers asking for a cesarean section, like I mentioned before, just because they want a surety and guarantee for the baby that things are going to be all okay. Shilpa asked me, what are the common reasons for delayed delivery after the due date? Which delivery preferred in the case? Now Shilpa, delayed delivery, we call term is like 40 and post term is 40 plus. Now Indian or other Asian babies, they mature before time. The lung maturity happens at 38 weeks, but in Caucasian babies, they mature slightly late. So in India, what we recommend is try not to cross your due date. If you get spontaneous pains by your due date, perfect. Otherwise, we ask you to induce. But waiting extra 6 days is not going to cause much harm if you do continuous regular in-home and hospital monitoring. Now, the reasons for delay most often is, let's say, a delay for a, you know, spontaneous pains most often is the disproportion for the baby and the mother, like a CPD kind of. If the baby is too big for the body, probably you not, it won't be able to push and create that kind of pressure to get into the labor thing. But there's not exactly something pinpoint that you can say that this is the reason for a delayed thing. Now Noor asks me, is it safe to have a tummy tuck after cesarean if planning a second pregnancy later? Noor, in the second pregnancy also, your belly is going to stretch up, right? So if, let's say, if you're planning for a tummy tuck, what I would recommend, you finish off your second pregnancy and then you give your best shot with the natural ways to tone up your belly. If not working, then you go for a tummy tuck. Now, Kirti, she asks me, is the mother always conscious during delivery? What is she is in too much of pain and give up between during normal delivery? Is that dangerous to her life? Kirti, normal delivery, yes, like I told you, it's too much of pain. It's something that you have never experienced before, so nothing can actually prepare you for that. But if you're physically and mentally ready during your pregnancy time, it makes it slightly easy. We have a lot of different painkillers that we can give you during the delivery process or during the labor process, which can ease that out. You are conscious throughout, of course. In a normal delivery, you are conscious. Even with the cesarean section, we give you something called epidural anesthesia, wherein you are still conscious. And the pain, of course, is too much, but you can't afford to give up, because that a baby can't afford. If you give up, it doesn't cause much trouble for you, but it can cause a lot of trouble for the baby. So that is what we do. We prepare yourself in pregnancy so that we do not face these issues around the time of delivery. Now Rita asks me, how do these birthing classes help a pregnant woman prepare for delivery? A very good question, Rita. So like I told you, nobody's actually prepared for a normal delivery. The pain, the process, 18 to 20 hours of grueling labor. So what we do is we give you proper information somewhere around, you know, 5 to 6 months of your pregnancy, and we keep in touch with you whether you understand or not, whether you're following the exercise, the breathing techniques, the cord sending techniques, so that it facilitates your labor process later. Now, the birthing class basically includes three different aspects. One, of course, is your nutrition, how to keep yourself healthy, not to be too overweight or not to be underweight. Second is your exercise, what all can you do to tone up your body, improve your stamina. And third is your lactation, how better can you, you know, prepare for your breastfeeding thing. So of course it makes a lot of difference. Somebody who is prepared, it makes it slightly easy than somebody who is not. Okay, so Umesh asks me, is it possible to know in the womb, we can know the baby had a antiposted anus, is it shown in sonography? So Umesh, I'm sorry, I'm not able to understand what you're trying to ask here. What probably, I think probably you're talking about something, some abnormality in the sonography, which was, you know, ultimately when the baby delivered, something was abnormal and they were not able to pick up on the ultrasound. But unfortunately, I do not understand the term that you mentioned. I'll get back to you later on that. Now, Shilpa asks me, is it possible to somehow dilate faster during labor? Okay, Shilpa, so we have certain medications available with us which can hasten the labor process. A few of them are used for induction, that is to start the labor thing, and few of them for augmentation, which can hasten it. So we have something which can give you in the which we can give you in the drip, and we can give you certain kinds of injections also. But having said that, not everybody responds to medication the same way. Everybody has a very different experience. For most people it does work, and for some it doesn't. Gitika, she asks me, if a lady has first cesarean section, I have missed it out. Where did it go? Gitika's question. Just give me a second, Gitika. Okay. Where did it go? Okay, if the lady has first cesarean section, will she have the second also through cesarean section only? Is it an unbearable when that previous section cut is stretched? Okay, so Gitika, not necessarily that if it's a first cesarean section, it's going to be 100% cesarean section. There are the criteria that I mentioned earlier. So if somebody gets to fulfill them, you have a decent chance at trying for a normal delivery second time. Now, when the previous cesarean section scar or the cut gets stretched, unfortunately, you wouldn't realize it much. That's the problem. Let's say if you complain of pain, we could act. But most often what happens is a silent give through. When you get into labor, slowly the cut becomes thinner and thinner and can open up. So there wouldn't be much pain between between trying for somebody who had an intact uterus than somebody who had a scar on the uterus. But the unfortunate thing is, once it opens up, the pain goes off. So this is something that we're not looking at. Now, other question Gitika asks is water birthing practice much in India? Not so much Gitika. What happens is water birthing means that it's like a swimming pool kind of a thing, and you are the patient is in the water, the doctor's in the water, the nursing staff is in the water. There is a lot of contamination happening and infection thing happening. So off late, we do not recommend a lot of we do not recommend water birthing. Rather than a lot of places in Bangalore who are strictly saying no to it. I'm one of those. I would recommend try, if possible, try not to go for that, because chances of infection is pretty high with that. Now there are certain places in Bangalore where they still do it, but I am not recommending it at the moment. So our time is up for the day, unfortunately. I hope I have been able to answer some of your queries. I'm pretty sure there are a lot that are still not answered. So if it is possible, I would recommend you to leave your questions, and I would try my best to post a question online, and so that it would help all of us. So it would great talking to you. Have a great evening.